Okay, this is Shroud of the Avatar R33. I've skipped a few releases on my videos because the Linus Client was in pretty bad shape for a few releases. There wasn't much point doing one in the last release because none of the interesting stuff was accessible early on. I'll talk about that a bit more later. I'm standing outside my house, which I placed on Monday at 1 o'clock. I actually wanted the lot around the corner, but someone else got it. We'll talk about the land rush later anyway as well. I just wanted to start here to show you some stuff. So we've always had this permission stuff on houses. So this is where you can set three levels of permissions for anybody on your house. In R31, they've also introduced for containers, essentially, that you can have much more detailed permissions. You can see them here. I've not done much experimenting with them because I've only had the house for 4 days. You can't expect me to have done much with it, but this should allow you to do quite a lot of different things as far as sharing containers in your house with other people and things like that. So yes, I'm in Ardoris. We're going to be covering in this video stuff that's new in R33, and also I will mention some stuff from R31 and R32, since I didn't do videos with them, sort of as we go along. So the first new thing for R33 I would like to talk about is these two. So Ardoris is the City of Love, and in R33 we now have a city populated with lovers. Return to your lover's embrace. Okay then, let's talk to him. Not really interesting lovers, but then, you know, it's quite often the fact that people who are in love aren't that interesting to everybody else. I'm down by the docks here. The other reason I wanted to start in Ardoris is that... Oh, let's grab this guy. What's your name? What is your name? It's Jason. Now you'll see Jason was heading towards this guardhouse here. This isn't the reason I wanted to start an Ardoris, although it's a good place, as place as any, because this is one of the updates for R33. So the general update is NPCs have schedules, and so Jason here, if we follow him, is going into the guardhouse. He's going into a room, and he's disappeared into the room, and there he is, going to sleep. So we'll see, there are various guards in there, some of whom I've not met yet. For some reason there are birds, but we're not worrying about them. So the guards do their shift patrolling, and then they head back to the guardhouse to get some sleep. They might do some other things as well, like going to pubs or something, we don't know. There's Tatoth Guard, who's in action. Here's this bloke over here. Theo. Alright, I don't really want to talk to Theo. So the guards are just one example. You also find that shopkeepers have their schedules, so this one's not at work. We're at dawn, obviously. So presumably this shopkeeper is upstairs in bed or something. We'll not bother looking for him right now. And there's some other shops down here, like Digit. He tends to be a late riser. So you'll see he's there in bed. Digit, he'll sell you a gust wall, but not when he's in bed. This has been the source of some consternation because there have been various bugs going on, stopping you handing in quests and stuff like that. It's generally quite annoying. Oh, there's another guard I've not met yet. Let's talk to him. What's his name? Isan. And it's also quite annoying for those of us doing videos because I've actually been stalling all this time because I wanted to talk to this bloke. And that bloke is Jeffrey Post, who I actually recommend you do talk to because there's quite a lot of dialogue there. It is quite amusing. But the reason I wanted to talk today is that he's introduced, he now gives you this emote, sneeze. So let me just try that out. There we go. Let's do it again from the front. Excellent. So, in a roundabout way, we have arrived at the theme of today's video, and that is there are in R33 five new emotes available if you talk to the right NPC characters. And my plan is to jog around the world and talk to all of them. We may be stymied in this effort by NPC schedules, but I think not every city has them in place yet, so we'll probably be alright once we get out of Ardoris. Now I am going to run here to the bank because I want to collect an add-on store emote that I purchased with my store credit. So if we just hit O to get the emotes up, you'll see all the ones I've managed to get so far. I'm going to double click on the banker. We're going to see a load of crap that I've not got an address eventually. I'm going to hit claim rewards. And we get potential network trouble. See how this works out. I've successfully gained. And if you notice, I have a new emote. We'll not breathe fire at the banker. We'll look at it in a minute. There are some things I want to grab from the bank. Or that should be in the bank. Right. So, some cool gear. Let us grab it. Aeronaut helmet, cool. There was another thing I was expecting. That's the one. We shall talk about them in a second. I think that was it. Yes. So, let's head outside into the square and do that one. There we go. Add-on store emote. So, the reason I just went through that bit is because it's one of the things that many people have struggled with. All your add-on store things are only available after you go to the bank and claim them with that button. This has confused a lot of new players. So, just covering that, you know, sadly, emote appeared directly in my emotes window rather than being an item in the bank, but you still have to claim it. So, switching to equipment, I'm carrying a load of crap with me. as we talk about some other things. Now, you'll notice, if you didn't notice already, I'm wearing wings. Wings were new in R32. You can buy them in the add-on store. You can also craft some. And if you spent $5 at the telethon, you will get to... You will get a set of wings for that. So this aeronaut's helmet was also a telethon reward. Looks pretty cool. I'll explain why my armor and stuff is glowing in a bit. And then the portable Aether vibration amplifier was a reward to everybody who'd pledged before Final Wipe, which was last release. Or maybe didn't mention that before. And the idea is, although I don't know how you do it, there we go, is when you wear them, you can listen to internet streaming. That's just, try it and see. No. Nothing. Let's stop. Let's try the other one. Now, there is, of course, an excellent chance that this doesn't work on Linux. I've never really tried it before. Oh, do I have to hit play? Did I do that already? It's not working, is it? Still, pretty cool, steampunky thing. Free gift for everybody. Gotta like it, really. Right, so enough of that fanning around for now. Let us head out of Ardaris. You there, Ronan. Take me to the main gate. Hi there, Marshall. Right, so the next emote to collect is in Sultan, so I'm going to head there. As we load up, I'll scroll through my notes. So, yeah, I mentioned persistence. Many view that as the point at which they should start playing. Many people did start playing, I think. So there's been quite a lot of helping new players and players surprised at game mechanics being the way they are that we've been experiencing for several months now. Nothing too bad, I don't think, but you know, things are in development. Now, persistence is not the same as release. The devs have been fairly clear about that. We still expect the game to be buggy, still a lot of content to be added, but it does mean that everything's now permanent, and quests you do will affect your character stats and things like that. Oh, a nice R32 feature is you can now press E, as like an action button, in many situations to rather than have to try and double click on things. It's actually really helpful if you're on a less powerful device, like when I'm on my laptop, because double clicks often don't work very well. Anyway, let's just see. Oh, you see there are actual children in the game now. That was R31 as well, I think. Rather than just small adults like there were before, that's an actual different model for children. So we're in Soul Town. You won't be surprised to hear that Soul Town was sold out very quickly. in the land rush. Now, what we're looking for here is the beggar. I don't know where he might be. Again, he might be on a schedule of some kind. Everyone's talked to the banker, but the bar's completely empty. Which isn't that surprising, considering it's the morning. Bentley, the man with the keys. So the guy we're looking for is called Chad. Slightly disorienting ceiling effects. So let's see if we can find Chad. Oh, if we wait long enough, will he appear somewhere? Oh, there he is, look, I think. Beggar. So we need to talk to Chad. He's trying to sleep. What's he standing up for then? So this is the joy of NPC schedules. Because it's morning. We can't talk to him. There's nothing else I really want to do in Soul Town. We might talk about the land rush some more. So, if you don't know how it works, so basically the land rush was split into 5-hour segments, I think, and each pledge tier was subdivided between royal founders, benefactors, and more recent pledges, and got a 5-hour slot in that order. Oh, Lord of Midnight was looking for the bank. Did he find it? And it all started on release day. When would it have been? Well, a month ago. And as I mentioned earlier, my pledge didn't let me place until Monday afternoon. At least for me it was the afternoon. For people on the central time it was 7 a.m. which I think gave me a bit of an advantage. And I was able to snag my row lot in Ardris. I've since then placed another two lots, which one in Brittany Fields, which I'll take you into later just to show you. See if we can talk to him again. He's still trying to sleep. It's morning. Everybody's up. Some children are out. So yeah, there are several quests you have to hand in this part. Oh, interesting. I'm getting help text because I've not been here. Not been here long enough. Oh, so these guys are getting up. Bentley and the Bard. Pathing issues there though. So many people feel this NPC schedules thing is more immersive. Oh look, here he is now, look. Coin. Deny. I've confirmed to fall grovel. I'm gonna give him a coin anyway. Yes. And now I'm gonna grovel. Let's try it. That's me grovelling. There you go. Alright, enough of that. Let's get up. Let's just confirm what his name was. What is your name? Okay, Chad. So that was right. So, we're off. We've done Chad. We will head now to Deathless and the Epitaph, which will mean going through the control point. I'm not going to stop and fight anything, I'm just going to leg it through. We can discuss at that point the nature of control points and things like that. And what should the nature be? So, one thing we will have to talk about at some point is taming. I have got some pets on me. We can't do it in the overland map, so let's leg it up. So as we pass through Solace Bridge, which you might be aware is the starting point for the Love quest line. In recent releases, the Love quest line has received a lot of focus. It's a similar layout, but the actual progress of the scene is much more refined. I may do a starting quest video at some point, just to replace the old ones, but I'll have to do it in single player now, because you can no longer visit all of the starting scenes with the same character. If you don't do the love quest, then there's certain things you can do in the starting scene that you'll never get to do. Right, now let me just do some taming stuff. So I did level up my taming yesterday. What do I want? Summoning is what I want. And then I need to equip my summoning whistle. Right, so Chesty, he is the starting world gift, so let's summon him and have a look. Ooh, lots of focus drain. I've got 10 minutes to the next one. So you'll see he only has 78 health now. He was massively nerfed, was Chesty, in the last release, R32 in fact. Whereas before you could send him around, he was a significant help. He basically, since R32, barely stays alive. So, remember, he was 78 health. I'm going to equip Crawley, who's a ferocious wolf spider. And I've got an 11 minute cooldown, so maybe when we get to Deathless, I'll summon him out and we can have a look at him. Let's for now run through the control points. And this has been a thing that new players have complained about, because picking up the mouse to deliver to Deathless is one of those quests that's easy to get quite early. And if you actually attempt to fight anything in Deathless when you're a new player, you will not get very far. It is still possible just to leg it through, which is what I'm tempted to do. I'll almost claim the control point. Interesting. So now they're attacking me. Oh, is that the person that claimed the control point? Yes, possibly. So, that's one of the inadvisable things you do. There we go, all rezzed up. Have another go. But as I've just demonstrated, although I'm fairly high level, it's fair to say, you can just run through and ignore everything. You don't need to stop and fight. And even if you do die, as you see at that point, you res outside the control point, you don't even have to open the door. I did contemplate doing a let's run through all the control points with a new character video. I may still do that at some point. But for most of them, as long as you know where you're going, it's quite easy to get around them, and as long as you don't mind dying. Anyway, Desolis is our next point of call. We might have some combat down here. Let's enter. The loading times have improved significantly over recent releases. Gone are the days where I feel the need to edit those bits out. Now, you may have noticed the text come up saying these areas are finished. You also get these these under construction signs all over the place to warn you that the scene is either incomplete or is currently a clone of another existing scene. So, I'm heading into the epitaph, which is that big ass thing on the top of the hill there, look. Now there is some quite, reasonably high level stuff in the epitaph. This is something they're doing right. So you maybe can't do this as a as a new player. Certainly be difficult. I did try it out before I started filming and I managed okay. So the epitaph is formerly the fortress of the Obsidian Order, which if you've read the novella, which was one of the pledge rewards, it's I think where the friend of the general guy is located at the start of the story. Anyway, in current times, it's a prison. So there's lots of prisoners. They're basically thrown in here and left to fend for themselves. I'm going to summon a fire elemental just to be setting things on fire with. And we'll go down here and do some combat. Now there is a lot of copper around here as well, if you're into that sort of thing. Let's snap it. Now this is a new look in this release, this sort of glowing effect. It wasn't mentioned in the release notes. But it does make it strangely a bit more obvious. There we go. Right, so we need to defeat these slimes. So what I want at this point is some of my fire things to go up. Come on. There we go. Come on, fire elemental. There we go. That's what I wanted. At some point I need to sort out my decks, eh? Really just got them set up for the for leveling up a bunch of skills. Now the slimes are annoying because you get them down to certain health and they split into two slimes. quite dead yet. Come on. We're surviving. There we go. We do indeed survive. Right. So, I'm not going to waste too much time. Too much time messing around down here, because we just want to get to the guy and get the emote. I'm just going to wait for my strength to return, however. That'll do. Go on, attack him. There we go. Let's do some healing. Philosophy. See how they're divided up there. The fire works well on them, has to be said. Onwards. So, I saw there's copper in that corridor. If you come in here, there's yet more copper. It pains me to run by it, but there we go. So we're looking for a prisoner. There are some nasty things located around here. There he is. So I'm just going to check around the corner for bad guys. There's one. Alright, cool. We'll let Fire Elemental deal with him. Right. So this is a mysterious prisoner. There's no escape. And food. So we've learnt Belch. How's the Fire Elemental getting on? He seems to be holding his own. Let's try that then. Lovely. Right, so we're getting out of it. Remember the way. That was the opposite. There we go. Past the copper. Back up the steps. Corpses and stuff. So in general, the epitaph's quite a cool scene. There's a troll around there somewhere. There's various quests you can pick up from the people up top. Worth checking out once you've leveled up a little bit. We're not going to spend any more time here today. So we're off. We've got Belch, so two more emotes to go. Let's see what I still need to talk about. I've talked about that. Now we might get to talk about crafting a bit. Alright, I can summon. So let us summon the Ferocious War Spider. 79. So that's the main nerf they've managed in this release, is that no matter how powerful the creature was before you tamed them, now they are only as powerful as your own abilities allow. Let's just check what my abilities are. They're not particularly high. So I've got 40 in obedience, I've got 40 in summoning, so that's one of the main things, and I've got 25 in combat training, which gives me some bonuses. But you know, essentially 79 hit points, the pet's useless. There's no combat that, or the number of combat encounters you're going to win because you've got the pet, especially not having the pet, is minuscule. If the opponents are that powerful, they'll overpower you. They'll still overpower you when you've got the pet. That's very narrow level of applicability. So everyone's expecting that it's just overcompensation. Pets were quite powerful in R32. Everyone was using them to level up. And it'll swing back a little bit the other way. So, just while we skirt around the Shardfall here, I will mention the Shardfalls are PvP areas. And PvP areas are intended to be richer in resources to compensate for the risk of entering them. What a lot of people were doing in the last release was entering them in single player or friends online mode, so that there weren't actually any other players for them to PvP with. And so that's also been nerfed in this release. Every time you enter a PvP area, you will be forced into multiplayer mode. Some people are unhappy about that. I'm just not going to go in there. Apparently they're quite pretty, so it's a bit of a loss, but what can you do? Right, so I'm at Brittany, which since I last did a first look video has grown to be a fairly massive undertaking. It's several separate scenes, so fields, estates, alleys, wharfs and central are all actual residential town scenes, and Brittany Graveyard, which I did in an earlier video, is the one that will have all of the backer tombstones in. I'm going to enter Brittany Alleys because I live there, sort of. My else account lives there, in fact, but I have access to the house, so we're just going to have a quick run through it. All of the Brittany scenes are quite distinct in their style. Alleys is sort of the poor area, so a whole lot of row houses. Estates is the rich area, supposedly. Fields is more of a rural farming scene. Brittany Central is like an urban scene with a castle. It's quite neat. We will come on, load in. I'm going to try and avoid going there. I'm just going to run through the alleys and back out again and try and not get lost, but I think it's a pretty cool scene. And because it's all row houses, quite tightly packed, I think it will become a fairly major shopping district, which you'll see what I mean when we get in there. Alright, it's under development. There's a town crier. Let's talk to him. See how much lag we get. Quite a bit so far. I'll take this opportunity to take a drink of water. So while we're waiting, you'll see already these are all row lots. You'll see vendors outside of each one. So in case I didn't mention it before, you can now buy vendors from I forget which one, housing merchants, for 10,000 gold. Oh, it's lagging pretty bad, isn't it? Well, really, I just wanted to see how many lots there were. I think there are quite a few. Somebody running around with the sword out. So there are a few castle lots, but nearly everything else is a row lot. So if you're looking for a lot of vendors close together, this is a good place for it. Now, as I went past that that vendor, you see several of them are talking about selling Kotos or Crowns of the Obsidians. You'll see I've got a few because I've been buying them. Now, these were introduced, you pay for them in the Adam store, $5 for 5. When you're first introduced, they let you buy potions from special alchemists. They now have several other purposes. One is they allow you to fully repair gear. So, if you're not aware, let me show you. Right, so you'll see that the maximum durability of my leggings is 80, and currently the upper limit is 78, and my current value is 68. So if I repair them with a repair kit, they'll only go back up to 78, not to 80. But if I repair them with a Crown of the Obsidian, jewelry. Oh, we're looking pretty bad. Then it will go back up to 80. So this is my alt account's house. Someone's been inside having a look around. There's nothing really in it at the minute though. Pardon me. Now the only other thing you can do with Kotos at the minute is pay your rent. So the rent on a row lot is 3,500 gold per week. And a crown, a single crown, is worth 3,500 gold. So generally, the way I look at it, if I see a crown for less than 3,500 gold on a vendor, I should buy it immediately and use it to pay my rent, because it will save me money. So that, the castle, the walls in the distance, is Brittany Central. If we go through that door, we'll end up there. I don't want to go there now. I want to head back in the way I came, rather than get trapped in the never-ending doorways of Brittany, and they are quite large scenes. So here I'm just, it's like a town square type thing, somewhere nearby. Sorry, lady. That's our look. Through we go. Right, so this is where the bank is, just there, and all the main shops, public vendor. So this is like the centre of the town. There's an airship manufactory, which is what that bit over there is. There's some docks down the way. Passing yet more vendors. There we go. Some docks down the way. And hopefully the way out is down this way. Oh, this Lardress. So, the original theme of this was that it was quite down at hill. You'll see some of the houses like those look quite decrepit. Of course, when everyone moves in, you get to put your own house, so it's all looking a little bit smarter. One interesting thing to note is that these shingle roof houses are now craftable if you've grandmastered carpentry. So I've not got there yet. There we go, here's the way I came in. The vendor, bit of a washout waiting for him. So anyway, that was Brittany Alleys, which I think is a pretty cool scene. introduced in R31. I can't get out. There we go. There we go. So my next come on. My next emote is in Yharnafjord, so we will need to pass through not a control point as such, but we need to run through a scene to get there. We can't just walk on the overland map. In fact, thinking about it, let us first go. No, we'll go to Yharnafjord. Just means I'll have to go through two control points. You can fast forward the video, it's fine. You don't need to listen to me rabbiting away. So I did discuss the taming nerf. One of the things the devs sort of offered up to compensate for that is you can now buy with Crowns of the Obsidians Obsidian Books of Unlearning. So at the minute on your skills, if you're high in a skill, you can, for instance, set it to unlearn. And you'll retain some of the experience that you previously put into that skill. But the rate at which you get it back is fairly small. Well, I'm not sure what it is, but it's not very significant. The Obsidian Book of Unlearning will get you 90% of that experience back on a single skill. We're all supposed to get one for free, but it didn't make the first build of R33, so I can't tell you how they work or what they do yet. Well, I can tell you what they do, but I don't know if they work or not. So we've got to run through this scene. Nightshade Pass. It's not actually a control point like the other ones. There is a control point in Hilt Fortress on top of the hill. What we want to do is basically run out that way. So I'm going to charge down. Try not to get into too much combat and just run through. So there have been some pretty bad defects on Linux since R29 and the combat changes. Everything has kind of sucked. It all got a bit much for me in R31. It is now playable, but there are still some weird things, like this water isn't supposed to look like that. These clouds aren't supposed to be opaque. But they have been on Linux for a few releases now. Alright. Oh, I went too far. Yes, I think I went too far. There we go. Let's run away. Will-o'-the-wisps, they were introduced a while back. I'll show you something cool in a minute. Let's just get away from all of these guys. Not like they can do a lot of damage to me. Here's the exit. Let's just do this. Because, you know, it fits in with the emote theme. No, I've got the thing wrong. Let's look it up. Juggle. Oh, there's no H. There we go. Neat, eh? That's an add-on still one. That was one of the things I bought in the telethon because it had a flash sale. I bought all those juggle add-ons. Do they serve any practical purpose? No. Do they look cool? Yes. I think they do. You may disagree. I'm not really that bothered. I like them. It's like a lot of stuff in the add-on store. It's just cosmetic stuff. Right, so we need to get to Yarnaford. Hopefully I'm not going to get lost on the way. You will have noticed that my armour has a sort of golden sheen. That's because it's enchanted. If I mouse over that, you see all the bonuses on my armour. Look, if I hit control, I'll stop walking. But you'll see I've got an exceptional bonus, an enchantment and a masterwork. So enchantment is done with see if you can't remember what stuff's called. Enchantment's done with alchemy, that's it. Whereas masterworking is done, in this case, with tailoring. You see that the masterworking, when it's first introduced, was just a single skill. Now you have separate bonuses for cloth and leather. In blacksmithing we get blades, plate armour, chain armour and shields. Carpentry, I've not unlocked all of that yet, but it's a similar thing. You also get, so you'll see that I've socketed it for fire, and while it gives a tumour, it also you have a chance as you craft things. So before you do the enchantment and or the masterworking, if you socket it, there's a chance that the bonus you get will be directly related to the gem you socketed. So the sorcery for fire, you get bonuses to particular fire spells and things like that. I've only had one of them come up so far. Not under construction again, and it wasn't one I actually wanted, so I've not got any gear I can show you that demonstrates it, but it is pretty cool. Right, now we're looking for one of the fishermen. Belching, what is your name? Jalal. I'm not looking for Jalal, I'm looking for Joshua. I don't think I know where he is actually. Let's go around this way. I think it's black. Fortunately, this scene hasn't yet. Got the Joshua Hugtight's the name. Kind of funny. Laughs so hard he coughs. Well, that is a bit of a stretch, I would say. Let's light it up, see what cough looks like. There we go. So we can cough and we can sneeze. We have a full range of expression as far as looking a bit sick is concerned. So, there's only one more. What I need to do is remember the way I came in. Another village. There we go. Oh yeah, that's obvious now. One more emote to get. I'm going to go through another control point to get to it. It should be a different style one. While I do that, I'll talk about a few more features. I might get my skills out again and give you a rundown. Right, let's just check things off my list so I don't get confused. Talked about that. Talked about that. Alright then, so we're heading to Aerie. Which is up this way, I believe. Now, South Church Hills, very nice area for leveling up, although it has been nerfed. Avertus, don't want to go in there. We want to go an easier one. Now then, the Apais Ruins. That reminds me of a thing I do want to talk about. So, we've been going over the Overground Network. There is an alternative method now of navigating around New Britannia. As the various sewers and cave networks and things are not, they're not completely done yet, but the intention is to link them all together, so it's possible to travel underground from, you know, say Ardoris to Brittany, if you know where you're going. And if you purple, that's granite, by the way. Kind of obvious for us Linux users in this release. But yeah, if you know where you're going and you have the correct keys, you should be able to just run through fairly quickly without having to do anything. So this is one of those trade-off things. If you don't want to be fighting bad monsters and control points, or possibly dying, you have to either buy a key off a vendor. Oh, hi Trent. Buy a key off a vendor or fight specific bosses. I'm just going to scroll through my inventory. I'm pretty sure, there we go. Kiln system to Midmare passage key, which I got for fighting a water elemental in the kiln system, which I got to by falling down a well in the Verdantis mines. It's all pretty cool. I couldn't replicate it to order at this point, but I may at one day do a video of that, because you know, I quite like this whole sort of alternate underground route to stuff. So there you go. I just did another control point with a very little dying. But yeah, that was, so the underground things really started to come together in R31 when they moved the Rise, which is one of the more famous dungeons in the game, to its permanent home, which I think you can get into from that control point I've just left, but we're not worrying about that. Not worrying about that for now. So we're coming at, oh, ah! So, new in R33, random encounters no longer just occur around Ardoris. They now occur all over the map. They're still easy. I'm fairly sure if I find anything to fight before I leave. A stag. Can we see anything worth fighting? No, it's not a combat one. So there are a few different scenes. You see, there's a lot of cotton there. Let's see if we get a beetle out of it, because that would at least make the thing worthwhile. I did a couple earlier today, and one of them had gold ore nodes in, and one of them had silver ore nodes in. No, a beetle. I'm not going to bother with it. So that's a significant upgrade in loot potential over what the old scenes were. They still don't present any sort of challenge though, because, you know, I could effectively stand still and have everything in the scene attack me, and probably wouldn't do a lot of damage because it was all green to me. I'm not even going to hit most of the time. But that is now something you can expect as you wander around Novia all over the place. Once again, figuring out which direction you were facing. There we go. Hopefully we won't get another one on the way to Early. Now that you've got the general gist of it. I still think that generally they're a waste of time at this page. At this stage, they're a... You can't really get XP out of the monsters. The resource nodes are low level to match the monsters. They're not at my level. So anyway, before we get dragged in, let's look at... So I was in blacksmithing earlier, and there's now a separate proficiency for salvage. And actually, in order to get your blacksmithing up to any decent level, salvage is an excellent way of doing it. Turning swords into metal scrap, which you can then use to also make the ingots. We'll talk a bit more on recipes in a bit, since we're now just passing Blood River. In this release, R33, Blood River has, the starting scene has had some improvements. I did Blood River in the last release. I can't do it again now, so I'll probably start up an offline single player game to have a look at it at some point. But it is now more polished, like the Love Quest line is in was for previous releases. Cal Hobbs. How entertaining. So yeah, one thing introduced in R32, one of the things introduced in R32, is that recipes now have a minimum skill level. I don't have any recipes on me to demonstrate, but for instance, a sword, you now need, I forget exactly what it was, I think it was 50 blacksmithing level, perhaps. I'll show you something about that when it loads up. And the houses I mentioned earlier, to craft a house, you essentially have to grandmaster carpentry to be able to do it. You can't even learn the recipe. So, it basically removes the issue of anybody being able to craft anything. So if we look at the carpentry, see, although I'm at level 77 in my carpentry proficiency, that only translates to a carpentry level of 62.1. And to learn the house recipe, I need a carpentry level, which isn't the carpentry proficiency, of 70, which you can see, even at level 97, I won't be at 70. So I'm assuming you essentially have to grandmaster it. So, we're here for our last emote. I think I've talked about nearly everything I wanted to talk about for this and the last two releases. It is true that since they went persistent, they've had to spend a lot of time patching exploits and generally maintaining the game, so there's not an awful lot of new content in R33. Apart from them balking the taming. So, Cat Lady. Hello, Cat Lady. Look at all them cats. Let's ask her what her name is. Felicia. Felicia Purdue. Savista. Mr. Wheelstick. Musicians. That's nicely. I've learned form conduct. So let's go for it. No. I spelled it with two U's, that's why. There we go. Let's conduct the cats. So, there we go. That's my R33 first look video. Mostly it's about the emotes. I am a lot more positive about this game after R32 than what I was 2 months ago, where it seemed like it would never work properly on Linux again. It's still doing some, you know, questionable things, like really the pet nerfing is just too much. Everyone said it's too much, they've done it anyway. But there you go, we'll see. Obviously it's not released yet. We expect it will come back a bit. I hope it does. I mean, I don't want to use pets that much, but they've got to be at least useful, haven't they? But apart from that, I'm liking the new scenes. I'm liking my new emotes. I'm liking all my free gifts from the telethons for pledging, or whatever it was I pledged during the telethons. It may not be finished by Christmas, but I've been having a lot of fun with it in the last month. Definitely most of the things that I played the game for in previous releases are still there. And, you know, I believe in the team. I think it will get better. Not necessarily all at the same time. Two steps forward, one step back and all that. But, yeah. Shroud of the Avatar, R33. That was me getting a load of remotes.